request presents an unabridged recording of Imposition by Ray Clark, narrated by Greg Wagland. Prologue. North Yorkshire. 35 years ago.
You've nearly done, Eric.
Elsie rose out of her chair, crossed the room, and placed two pieces of coal on the fire to last them through the news. She then turned up the sound on the TV.
"The hell are you doing in there, love?"
she asked, moving a small coffee table between the two chairs.
"You'll be the death of me, woman,"
he said, closing the door into the kitchen with his left foot, while balancing a tray with two cups of cocoa and a saucer of chocolate digestives.
"They will," she replied, nodding towards the biscuits. "You eat far too many. Only pleasure I get. Anyway, what's the rush? It hasn't started yet."
He stepped back, drawing the curtain between the dining and the living room. Elsie chuckled.
That was her, Eric. Tide and time waited for no man, but you couldn't rush him into anything.
She was still proud of their small terraced house. It had been their first and only purchase, bought as a new build, moved in the day after they were married, back in the 60s. It was clean and tidy, but it needed a spruce-up. Painter and decorator he might be, but he rarely found the time to renovate their own house, too busy doing everybody else's. Eric parked his carcass. The 10 o'clock news had pretty much been a nightly ritual as long as they had been together. A cup of cocoa, a few biscuits, the news, and then bed. "Wonder what's been happening today?" asked Eric.
"Something has. I saw Jean Parkin in the town this afternoon, picking up a piece of brisket for their weekend joint. White as a ghost she was."
"Why?"
"Not sure. She wouldn't say much about it. Is she ill or something?"
The newscaster announced the headlines, and they immediately noticed a view of the Grade 2 listed swing bridge over the River Esk, before the shot cut to a street of detached houses.
"Don't think so, but if we watch this, I think we're about to find out."
Eric lifted his cup and took a sip. In the studio, the face of the newscaster was solemn. "Detectives have launched a murder inquiry following the discovery of two bodies in a house in the North Yorkshire seaside resort of Whitby earlier today. A member of the public alerted the police when the front door of the house was seen to be open. The names of the deceased have not been released, as police continue their investigations and attempt to contact relatives."
"Good God."
Eric lowered his cup. "That's a bit close to home, Elsie, love." The shot changed to an exterior view of the houses from the street, with a reporter standing before them.
"They must be freezing," thought Elsie.
It was mid-November, and she could see his breath. Neighbours described the deaths as a tragedy in what was considered a very secure area.
"You're not safe in your own home these days," said Eric.
Elsie made no comment. Her eyes were focused on what was happening. Forensics officers, wearing light blue protective clothing and white masks, flittered in and out of the large tent stationed before one of the houses.
"That looks like the posh area up on the cliff top. Valley Road cuts between Mulgrave and Upgang, near to where the pub is."
The camera panned out. The area remained cordoned off with blue and white police tape, and uniformed officers standing guard outside. Flowers had already been left outside the property.
"Did the parking woman say who it was?"
"No," replied Elsie.
"But she reckoned it was a right mess inside."
"What?
She found them?"
"No, she doesn't live there, but she's a friend of the woman who lives next door. It was her husband who found them. Blood all over the place."
"Sounds a bit dramatic."
Eric took a digestive. "I doubt it was that bad.
Wouldn't surprise me."
The presenter continued, "No arrests have been made, and post-mortems will be carried out."
"Why?"
Eric asked, staring at his wife.
"It's Alfie Peterson's place."
"The Cockney?"
"The gangster, more like."
"We don't know that."
"I reckon you have a short memory, Eric. I'll not forget what he did to us."
"There was no proof, Elsie, love."
"I don't need proof. I know his type."
"How can you? We've lived here all our lives, never left the place. How can you know what people like him are like?"
"I know right enough."
Tears formed in Elsie's eyes.
Happen our son might come back home if he's watching this.
Aye, replied Eric, standing up, still staring at the TV, and happen not.
The news report finished.
Anyway, she said, rising from her seat, I've no wish to talk about it.
She headed for the kitchen with her cup.
I'm ready for my bed. Are you coming?
No, seeing as it's Friday and I've no work tomorrow, I thought I'd pull a late one. Think I'll watch that film Alan Hardacre lent me.
Chapter 1. Present Day. Desk Sergeant Morris Cragg heard the steaming kettle coming to the boil in the other room. Peering at the clock above his head, he reckoned he had around 10 minutes to make his drink before settling down to watch a repeat of Armchair Theatre. Morris smiled to himself as he stood up. He remembered ITV's flagship drama the first time round, in the 70s. He and his late wife, Veronica, passed many an hour watching them, if he wasn't working the late shift, him with a beer, her with a sherry. The kettle switched off, breaking Morris's thoughts. He was in the back room of the police station in Bramfield, which resembled a sitting room with a table and chairs, a three-piece suite, an open fireplace, a wooden floor covered by an assortment of rugs, and ancient, yellowed wallpaper. It was all he had, but he liked it. Carrying his empty mug into the kitchen, he rinsed it in the sink, threw in a tea bag and poured the boiling water in. Delving into a tin in the cupboard above his head, he grabbed a handful of biscuit. Munching away, his thoughts returned to his late wife again. She'd been gone 8 years. Her life had been taken in the middle of Lidget Hill in Pudsey by a hit-and-run. A drunk driver ran a red light. She'd had no chance, killed instantly. The driver was still in prison. But then so was Morris, after a fashion. He added milk and sugar to the cup before strolling through into the sitting room area, keeping a watchful eye on the front desk. Not that much ever happened in Bramfield during normal hours, never mind after the witching hour. Following Veronica's death, endless bills from credit card companies, department store cards and catalogues soon mounted. If there was money to be spent, she had no equal. He'd had to sell everything to keep his head above water. His home, his life and his job were all now based around the small country station in Bramfield. He had friends, although he hadn't seen any of them for a while. That was the late shift for you. He leaned forward, switching on the TV, the only thing left from the marriage. Out in the lobby, the station door burst open, crashed against the wall, and slammed shut again. Christ! Cragg jumped, knocking into the table. Where's the fire? He turned and rushed through, unsure of what to expect. What he saw confused him. The room was empty. Chapter 2. The existence of the everyday, hard-working burglar had been a whole lot tougher more recently. First a recession, then Brexit. Fucking pandemic wasn't help either. People at home more, keeping a closer eye on their possessions. The police were tightening up. More sophisticated procedures. But he kept himself in the know. He knew all about DNA 17 technology. The biggest change to DNA profiling in 15 years. According to what he'd heard, because he wasn't that hot on reading, DNA 17 was so good that if you farted, you left a trace a mile wide. Manny laughed at that. Sources had informed him that the new DNA 17 profiling had CSI's swabbing glove marks for a full profile. They reckoned that when you put gloves on, you usually touch the outside with your hands, leaving a trace of sweat. The swabs pick it up. There was no way they'd find a trace of him, not with three pairs of underpants and three pairs of gloves, not to mention a hairnet and mask. Couldn't take any chances. Bastards, why couldn't they leave Manny and his kind alone? Give them a break now and again. Situated in a part of the town considered well out of the way, Swansea Court had four detached houses. He was pretty sure number two was empty. He'd studied the front of the house for the last half hour, watching the bedroom with the light on. But there had been absolutely no movement, no one coming or going. Around the back, he'd kept watch for a further 15 minutes. Nothing. Now he'd finally summoned the nerve to stroll down the path. It was time to steal and shoot, before someone did come home. Who lived here and where the hell they were was a complete mystery to Manny, but he could live with that. Manny confidently held the window frame, peering around the edge. His eyes opened wide, and he whistled through his teeth. The place was a mess. Maybe the gaff had already been turned over. The kitchen was upside down, drawers had been pulled out of units, cupboard doors left open. The table was piled high with everything, papers, bills, cups, saucers, plates, and the silverware. Stuff was all over the floor. Manny rubbed his gloves together. The Lord really had given him the green light. If someone else had burgled the place, they may have been stupid enough to leave their prints all over the scene, which meant he could go in and take what was left, and perhaps be lucky enough to escape hassle-free. The first thing Manny saw was a pair of trainers. Not simply any trainers. These were Vans. Definitely expensive. He reached down, pulled the right one toward him. With a bit of luck, they would fit. Dropping his swag bag, Manny carefully reached further into the room to a collection of carrier bags in the corner. He placed one on the floor and removed his shoes. He stepped into the trainers and tied the laces. Perfect. He slipped his own shoes in another carrier bag and left them on the back doorstep. Stroke of genius. Everywhere he walked now, he would be doing so in the trainers of the man who owned the house, and you'd certainly expect to find his footprints everywhere. He carefully negotiated the room, bag in hand, peering into all the cupboards and drawers. He found very little of interest. Lousy bastard. Whoever had been here before had no consideration for anyone else. He checked the fridge before moving on. He found chocolate ring donuts in a bag, as well as a number of energy drinks. Now you were talking Manny's language. He scoffed two of the donuts and downed a can. He threw the empty in his bag. Safety first, thought Manny. The living room was a little tidier. The TV screen on the wall was probably the biggest he had ever seen, so that was no use to him. It was too well fastened anyway. A number of paintings of horses adorned the rest of the walls. He didn't want those either. The room was also furnished with an incredible amount of equine ornaments. There was even a fucking rug with a horse's face on the floor. Keith Lemon would have a field day. Manny laughed at his own thought. Turning his attention to the hi-fi unit, Manny froze, almost certain he had heard something from the floor above. Crouching down, he waited, listened further. He wasn't sure why burglars crouched down. Stupid, really. If anyone came in and switched a light on, you'd hardly be perfectly placed to make a move, would you? He lingered long enough to realise it was probably his nerves playing tricks on him, remembering the first time he'd taken up his new hobby. He was so nervous, he actually shit himself. He wasn't too happy, but the old hands in his trade had had a good laugh about it. They'd all done it. They hadn't thrown up afterwards, though. Manny stood back up, using a small pen torch to rifle through the CDs. They were crap, as far as he was concerned. Fetch a few quid in the pubs or on the market stalls. But he definitely wouldn't be listening to them. Glam rock? Who the fuck listens to that stuff? An entire shelf had been dedicated to Slade CDs, mostly originals, possibly a lot of bootleg stuff. Manny reckoned there was some money's worth here. The owner of the house was very obviously a collector. So was Manny, and he was collecting these. Proper money here. Manny bagged the lot and moved on. In the front hall, he came across two things of interest. One was a shitload of music gear, amplifiers, speakers, guitar case, leads and extensions. The man of the house was obviously a musician. But if the place had already seen one burglar, why would he have left the expensive music gear? The heavy stuff, yes. But the guitar? Manny opened the case carefully. It was a nice bit of kit. Not that he knew much about guitars.
It had the Fender logo and he knew they were good. Manny could make a fair bit here. He closed and latched the case and moved that, as well as his swag bag, to the back door. The second point of interest was an unlocked door. Inside, the cupboard was nothing out of the ordinary. Tall and narrow, with a number of shelves containing a selection of boxes. Manny checked his watch. Well, it wasn't his, but he was taking damn good care of it. He really didn't want to waste too much time in case the homeowner returned. A quick peek wouldn't hurt. It was mostly crap to do with horses, horseshoes, small bits of tackle used for riding. One was even full of hay. Who was Manny robbing tonight? He forgot the boxes and shone his torch toward the floor. More stuff connected to music in the shape of vinyl. He checked. More Slade. He figured it was collectible, and he could probably carry it. The floor of the cupboard was timber. One of the boards squeaked as he stepped on it, indicating it was loose. Manny found a screwdriver, knelt down, forced the board upwards. Inside was a lockable metal box. Very interesting. Peering deeper into the cupboard revealed a key under a carpet. Most people were stupid enough to leave keys nearby. The box was about 15 inches by 12 and perhaps a foot deep. He unlocked and removed the top. Now what do we have here, thought Manny. I think we'll have these. Never know what's in them. Silly bastard probably doesn't even know he has them. Manny closed and locked the top, then put the key in his pocket. What you've never had, you don't miss. He closed the cupboard door and carried the box to the rest of the stuff he'd piled up near the back door. Manny was aware that his luck couldn't really last out much longer, but he would have to check the upstairs. No burglar worth his salt would leave a possible treasure trove uninvestigated. The room to avoid would be the one with the light on. He doubted anyone was in there, but knowing his luck, no matter how good it had so far been, some arsehole outside would be walking his dog, irrespective of the time. That would be curtains for Manny. But at the top of the stairs, he suddenly froze. Manny had clearly heard a loud click, as if the timer for the central heating had kicked in. But he couldn't be sure. Chapter 3. Crag glanced around. It didn't make sense. The door leading outside was perfectly still, as if it hadn't been opened at all, but he knew it had. You couldn't imagine a sound like that. Hello? No reply came. He moved forward, placing his hands on the counter, his finger on the panic button. To call it a panic button was a bit excessive. What it actually did was send a Wi-Fi signal to the computer in the patrol car and the phones of the men in uniform, which basically said, "Whatever you're doing, come back to the station." "Is there anyone there?" he called out again, walking to the end of the counter and lifting the hatch to step into the main room, where he received yet another shock. To his left was a man on his knees. Even though he was crouching, Crag figured he had to be 6 feet tall at least, with a solid, muscular frame. He had wavy black hair combed back in an Elvis style. His features were chiseled and tanned. He was dressed in a black leather jacket and jeans and wore a check patterned shirt. His arms were stretched out in front of him, with his hands bunched into fists, resting on the floor. He was shaking, breathing heavily. "Oh, God," he said quietly. Crag moved forward quickly, bending down. A closer inspection revealed the man was sweating. Although the desk sergeant didn't know him, his face was familiar. He had seen him around the town on the odd occasion. "Are you okay, sir?" The man flinched at Crag's question. Perhaps he'd been attacked, though the desk sergeant could see no evidence of that. But he knew enough about the way people fought these days to know that they didn't always leave any outward signs. Crag put his hands on the man's shoulder. Come on, sir, let's get you up and into a more comfortable position. Can you tell me your name?
The man pushed Cragg's arm away, not violently, but very gently, considering his size.
I need help.
Of course you do, replied Cragg, and that's what I'm here for, to help you. Let's get you to the other side of the counter, into a chair, and you can tell me what's bothering you.
Once again, he refused Cragg's help, but stared at him.
It's not me that needs help, it's her.
Who?
The situation had suddenly grown more urgent. Cragg needed answers. Who needs help?
My wife.
The man suddenly sunk to the ground, placing his head in his hands.
Oh, God, no.
Cragg put his arm on the man's shoulder. Please, sir, I need to know what's going on. Who are you? Cragg was about to ask another question when the man suddenly spoke.
Robbie Carter.
Good, Robbie. Well done. Now, can you tell me your wife's name? Robbie Carter rubbed his hands down his face. Tears formed in the corner of his eyes.
Jane. It's Jane.
There was a pause.
I think she might be dead.
Dead? Cragg repeated. You think your wife is dead? Robbie Carter lifted his hands and grabbed Morris Cragg's shoulders. He started talking, fast, as if he was reading out bullet points.
I'd been out all night, came home, on the floor. She was on the floor, in the bedroom.
His breathing turned to sobs.
Place has been burgled. Mess all over. I think she's dead, Sergeant. She needs help.
Cragg stood up quickly, staring into Robbie's eyes. He said, Mr. Carter, I want you to tell me where you live. Now, it's very important. Please tell me where you live.
Swansea Court, number 2.
That's out near the leisure centre and the school, isn't it? Carter simply nodded. Cragg moved faster than he had done in years. Around the other side of the counter, he picked up the phone and dialed the hospital. When the receptionist answered, he barely gave her time to take a breath.
Louise, it's Morris Cragg at the station. I need an ambulance and I need it now. 2 Swansea Court. There's no time to waste. Woman upstairs on the bedroom floor. Her name is Jane. Her husband says she may be dead. He doesn't seem sure. He's very distressed. Quick as you can.
Right away, Mr. Cragg. Cragg replaced the receiver and came back around the counter. Robbie Carter was still kneeling on the floor.
Mr. Carter, I have to ask, have you seen the offender at all?
Robbie didn't say anything.
Mr. Carter, I need you to tell me everything you can. It's important.
Robbie stared vacantly ahead, past Cragg. The desk sergeant couldn't take any chances. He couldn't allow an ambulance crew into a dangerous situation. So he came around the counter and threw into the back room. The television had warmed up and the episode of armchair theatre he'd planned to watch was well underway. He grabbed the handset on the radio and called the patrol car. The radio crackled in reply.
What can I do for you, Sarge?
I'd like both of you round to number 2 Swansea Court right now.
Ambulance is on its way. Woman either dying or possibly dead. Her name is Jane Carter. The husband's here at the station. The house has been burgled. Suspect may still be on the premises and very possibly further life at risk. Proceed with caution, and I'll get some more backup out to you.
On our way.
Out in the lobby, the sound of a mobile phone broke through, which was followed by a scream so spine-tingling that Morris Cragg dropped the handset and raced back to the front desk. Robbie Carter was still on the floor, staring at his phone, with an expression dark enough to curdle milk.
What's wrong, Mr. Carter?
Robbie's eyes were wide. Spittle had formed at the corners of his mouth. He showed Morris Cragg his phone.
He's still there,
Carter hissed. Chapter 4. 2 squad cars pulled up at the house within seconds of each other, blue lights flashing, but no sirens. The 4 officers jumped out in unison, and Constable Mike Atherton took charge. His partner, Emma Longstaff, had only been with the team for 3 months. She was 20 years old and a direct replacement for the late PC Gary Close. Atherton recognised the other 2 officers from Pickering as Dave Reynolds and Steve Smart. He issued orders.
Steve, Dave, can you go round the back? Emma, you come with me.
Swansea Court was a small cul-de-sac with four houses, each one detached. Two stood opposite each other on the way in. The other two were located at the bottom behind the small island used as a turning circle. Number two was the only one with a light on in the bedroom. Everyone else was obviously still in bed, unaware of the drama. Atherton pushed open the gate and raced up the pathway. He had a very uneasy feeling about the whole thing. Cragg had said the woman was either dying or dead, with a possible suspect on the premises. He doubted very much the man would still be there now. The front door was locked. "Emma, can you wait here? Keep your eyes and ears open, and please be careful." A shout from the back informed Atherton that the officers had found an open window. On both counts, life at risk and suspect on the premises, the scene had to be treated as a coordinated, fast approach. Fresh in his mind were the five building block principles, of which the first was preservation of life. Dispensing with formalities, he barged straight inside. The other two were close behind, and one of them instantly located a light switch. His immediate view of the kitchen was a mess. Even pigs wouldn't live in such a sty, which backed up the burglary theory. Atherton jumped over a variety of items on the floor and pushed his way into the front hall. Switching on another light, he cast a quick glance at the musical gear in front of the main door. "Check the living room, Steve." Emma Longstaff followed Mike Atherton as he bolted up the stairs, two at a time. Atherton had one hand on his truncheon and the other on the banister, calling out as he did so. The bedroom with the light on was the obvious choice. Once in, he saw a white female laid on the floor on her left side, with her right arm outstretched as if she was trying to reach out for something. She was slim, with long black hair and hazel eyes. She was wearing a fluffy pink dressing gown that had come open at the front, revealing a see-through black negligee underneath and a pair of white panties, no bra. He immediately knelt down and called out her name. "Jane, can you hear me, love?" Longstaff had checked the rest of the upstairs rooms, in which all lights were now blazing, before she joined Atherton. "All clear." Atherton leaned over the woman on the floor. "Jane?" There was no response. He felt for a pulse, lowered his head to her chest. Nothing. He glanced at Longstaff and shook his head. "Has she gone?" "Definitely." During the initial response, it was sometimes difficult to determine if a death was the result of natural causes, an accident, suicide, or homicide. Atherton couldn't clearly put it into any of those categories. First impressions, no blood, and little or no evidence to show what had actually happened. No external marks were evident on her face. He quickly checked the areas he could see for cuts and bruises, but found nothing. "What do you think?" he asked his colleague. Smart and Reynolds had joined him. "All clear downstairs?" "Hard to say," replied Longstaff. "Looks like she was ready for bed. It's still made up, duvet folded back. Maybe she'd just come up here, used the bathroom, and was just turning in." "Heard a noise downstairs, maybe?" said Smart. "If she did, she certainly didn't go and check. Otherwise, why have we found her up here?" Atherton asked. "In that case, the burglar was obviously pretty quiet and took her by surprise." "Not sure about that either," replied Atherton. "Look around the room. I can't see any sign of a struggle, can you?" "Bathroom's a mess," replied Reynolds. "Maybe it all happened in there." "Why drag her in here?" asked Smart. "I'm with Steve on that one," replied Atherton. "Can't see any evidence of that either. If he'd dragged her from the bathroom, surely something would have been left in its wake." "Not for us to try and determine," said Reynolds. "We'll need the CSIs to work their magic." Atherton stood up. His bad feeling about the crime scene was still with him. As he glanced around, the five building block principles kicked in again. Preservation of life was out of the window. He'd broken rule two by not preserving the scene so far, but that couldn't have been helped because he was too busy applying rule one. Although they knew the victim's name, she would still have to be identified officially. As for suspects, there were none, as yet. That only left securing evidence,
And there didn't seem to be much of that either, certainly not as far as the death was concerned. He suspected the place would be littered with prints from the theft, but, as his colleague had said, that was up to the CSIs. If the burglar did kill her, how the hell has he done it? Longstaff leaned in towards Jane Carter's body. Can't see anything on the outside, so it must be something on the inside.
Maybe he's poisoned her, said Reynolds. What with? Asked Atherton.
Could be anything, said Reynolds, eyes darting around the room. Not that I can see any signs.
He'll have taken it with him.
Can you see any puncture marks on her skin? Asked Longstaff.
Not on any of the visible areas, replied Atherton.
It's all a bit strange, isn't it? Said Reynolds.
How do you mean? Asked Smart.
There's only four possible options for loss of life. Reynolds held up his fingers to count them off. Natural causes, which it could always be. Accident, but no evidence to suggest it. Suicide, doesn't seem very likely to me. Once again, lack of evidence. Or homicide.
The reason was left unsaid, but Atherton could tell from their expressions that they were all of the same opinion. Something didn't add up.
In that case, let's get out of here.
And start treating it like the crime scene it is, said Atherton. We shouldn't disturb anything else until the big boys get here.
Can you two secure front and rear entry?
Emma, take one of the cars down the end of the street and block it off. We need a crime scene log.
Have you guys got any stepping plates in the car? We need to establish one route in and one out.
Not enough, said Reynolds.
I'll call Cragg, ask him to have some more sent over, and while he's at it, he can call MIT. This one's way beyond us.
Chapter 5.
So, what's happened here, Sean?
Detective Inspector Gardner was standing over the body of Jane Carter. Having made an initial examination, he was waiting for the Home Office pathologist, Dr. George Fitzgerald, to arrive. Detective Sergeant Reilly was peering into the top drawer of the bedside cabinet. He pulled out 5 £10 notes.
Not what people will want us to believe, I'm sure.
Gardner had received a call from the desk sergeant about an hour and a half previously. Because Mike Atherton's report was so detailed, Gardner saved time by calling his own team in immediately. Following a meeting with Atherton and a brief inspection of the bedroom, the SIO had issued a number of fast-track actions. Despite time having passed from the initial reporting of the murder, he had decided to apply the golden hour principle that the offender may still be in the area. It would only need two of his team to do a house-to-house to talk to possible witnesses, so the rest he sent off around the town.
What time did Cragg say that Robbie Carter reported the crime?
Gardner asked Atherton, checking his own watch.
6 o'clock.
Around 2 o'clock.
And the place had already been burgled. He found his wife on the floor, dying or dead. He didn't seem to know which.
I'm finding that hard to believe, replied Reilly, but not as hard as the fact that he didn't call an ambulance immediately.
That's what I was thinking. How long would it take him to get to the police station?
Reilly shook his head. 10 minutes if he drove.
I'm not happy, Sean. He gets home around 1:30, from wherever, finds the place upside down, his wife either dying or dead. He doesn't call an ambulance. Instead, he goes straight to the police station.
Gardner stopped talking, staring at Reilly.
But it appears that he sets the alarm before he goes.
Why does he do that?
Shock, offered Reilly. Grief, maybe?
They can make you do funny things.
I realise everyone reacts differently, but isn't there a basic instinct that kicks in, where just for one second you don't believe she's dead?
Where you think that you might just be able to save her, no matter what, no matter how much the evidence says otherwise.
You would still call that ambulance first.
Why didn't he?
Gardner's thoughts were with his late wife, Sarah, and that fateful night in the centre of Leeds when she had taken a bullet. He hadn't been able to save her, but he'd made sure an ambulance was called immediately.
I'm sure we'll get the chance to ask him.
Glancing around the room, Gardner noticed a number of photographs of Jane Carter with a variety of different horses, and only one of her and her husband.
At least he figured that was who it was, judging by the description Crag had given them. He strolled over and picked up one, studying it. While Robbie Carter was reporting it to Crag, his phone went off and relayed some pictures of a burglar in the house from the alarm system, which suggests the burglar had been somewhere on the premises the whole time, said Reilly, stepping out of the bedroom, staring into the corner of the landing, pointing to a motion sensor. Gardner followed his line of vision, but couldn't see any cameras. Maybe, said Gardner. But where was the burglar when the motion sensors were set off? Up here. There are no signs of a struggle. No sign in the bedroom either. Gardner walked back into the bedroom, his scene suit rustling as he did so. He pointed to a chair. That's the only thing that has moved recently. Look closer at the floor, you can see the imprints of where it used to stand. Reilly did so, not enough to suggest a fight, and there's money still in the top drawer of that cabinet. This alarm business is bugging me. Why did he set the alarm when his wife was in the house? Dying? You think he might be in on this? Wouldn't be the first, would he? Insurance scam? Let's see, when we talk to him, see if we can figure out his body language. Gardner turned back onto the landing and walked into the bathroom, to the mess on the floor. Overall, the space was clean and tidy, as was the shower cubicle. On the window ledge, he saw toothpaste, brushes, soap in a dish, and a face cloth neatly folded. A bottle of bleach stood at the side of the toilet. Gardner pulled up the toilet seat to peer inside. Clean water. That lot on the floor looks like an accident to me, not the result of a tussle. If it got out of control in here, said Reilly, they'd have needed to disable her in some way so they could drag her into the bedroom. Which means that some of that stuff down there would have ended up on the landing. Reilly nodded and turned his head. I'm not fully convinced that the burglar is responsible for Jane Carter's death. It almost looks like he hasn't been up here. As Gardner studied the items on the floor, one in particular stood out. He bent down and retrieved a small glass bottle of pills. He had absolutely no idea what they were, couldn't pronounce the name. He unscrewed the cap and shook a few into his right hand. They were small and circular, with a hard, shiny, polished surface. Interesting, said Gardner. Reilly studied the rest of the toiletries on the floor, also inspecting the smashed bathroom cabinet. Looks like the only bottle. Freshly opened as well. The label says there should be 100. It won't be far off. Prescription? Inquired Reilly. Definitely. Could be another option here, said Reilly. Maybe Jane Carter was in the bathroom getting ready for bed when she was startled by a burglar. They have a fight, things get broken, she has a medical problem, takes a turn for the worse, and the burglar bails out, leaving her to it. Possibly, either that, or like we said, the burglar didn't make it up here. Maybe Jane Carter was getting ready for bed and suddenly felt unwell. She couldn't reach the tablets in time. She panicked, lost her sense of balance, brought this lot down on herself, and ended crawling back into the bedroom when she couldn't find the pills, suggesting she wasn't attacked at all. A familiar voice from the ground floor broke their conversation. Reilly smiled. Is that the sharp reptilian voice of our beloved Pathosaurus just arriving? Don't you go winding him up, said Gardner. As if. Fitz's tall, lean frame came bounding up the stairs. His wrinkled, grandfatherly complexion greeted them. Good morning, gentlemen, he said, pushing his half-lens spectacles further up his nose. In his right hand he held a black medical bag. Reilly held his chest and feigned a fainting. What's up with him? Fitz asked. He's probably wondering the same about you, replied Gardner. When have we ever called you out to a scene, day or night, and you've greeted us like the human beings that we are? Reilly asked. Fitz simply stared on. You're right, I'm so sorry. Good morning, Stewart. Both detectives laughed. Gardner took Fitz into the bedroom, explained what he knew, before informing him that he was going to check on something downstairs while Fitz examined Jane Carter. Before leaving, he asked the pathologist about the pills. He couldn't help,
so Gardner bagged them and gave them to him to take back to the morgue. Downstairs in the living room, four CSIs were busy taking the place apart, one in each corner, two on the floor, combing through the carpet, and two others peering into the cupboards. Gardner made a beeline for the photos on the walnut-finished sideboard. As with those upstairs, most of them featured Jane Carter with a number of horses. In three of them, she held a trophy. As Gardner glanced around the room, he couldn't locate those trophies. He'd be surprised if a burglar had lifted them. They were too easily traceable. "Why do you keep looking at the photos?" Reilly asked. "See if it'll give me a clue to the state of the marriage. Looks to me like she was more in love with her horses." "Precisely." Of all the photos Gardner had seen, only two of them featured Jane and Robbie together, one upstairs, in which they were both smiling, and the one he now held, no smiling. Gardner made a mental note. I wonder how he sees the relationship. Probably not the way she did, from the look of that pic. Turning back to the sideboard, Gardner leaned further in, noticing circles in the dust on its surface. Yet further evidence that the burglar had been busy on the ground floor of the house. Steve Fenton, the crime scene manager, entered the room. "We just found this on the stairs." "What is it?" Gardner asked, staring at an empty evidence bag. Reilly smirked. "You should have gone to Specsavers." "You need to look really close," said Fenton. "It's a hair." Reilly leaned forward, squinting at the bag. "Looks like I'm not the only one whose eyes don't work," said Gardner. "Away with you, man. Can't you see I'm trying to concentrate? Thought I could smell burning." Gardner took the bag from Fenton. The hair was long and black and was almost certainly Jane Carter's. Forensics would confirm. "We found it at the top, caught in the skirting board," said Fenton. "No doubt we'll get confirmation from those in her hairbrush." "Could it be the first sign of a confrontation?" asked Gardner. "If it is, it started downstairs," said Reilly. Gardner studied the four corners of the room, glancing at the motion sensors. Still no cameras. A heated argument, maybe, got out of hand? "Some argument," said Reilly. "But if that's what happened, no burglar would drag her all the way upstairs." "Surely someone would have heard her screams of protest," suggested Fenton. "I doubt it," replied Gardner. "There's only four houses on the street, and they are a bit of a distance from each other." "Not to mention the time it was supposed to have happened," said Reilly. Gardner sighed. That gave them three separate crime scenes now. The body was scene one, where the body was found was scene two, and scene three was the burglary. The problems were mounting. "The best we can hope for is plenty of prints," said Reilly. "Good work, Steve. Keep checking," said Gardner, passing back the evidence bag. As Fenton made to leave, Gardner called him back. "Have you come across the computer yet?" Fenton pointed. "In there." Gardner noticed a desk in an alcove with a computer tower and monitor on top. Behind, on the wall, were shelves containing books and DVDs, a number of ornaments, and a couple of the trophies he had presumed were in the photos. "Can you pack the whole thing up now and get one of the lads to take it back to the station immediately?" Fenton nodded. "It's all a question of timing now. I want to see that system he's got installed. I want to know if the computer recorded the time of the alarm being set, when and where the first motion sensor was tripped, and who was responsible." Reilly had found a pile of CDs on the floor. Plenty of these, but nothing to play them on. Looking at the marks on the wall, I'd say they had a whole lot more than this. Burglar obviously has a market for them. And the hi-fi. Might be a good place to start asking questions. The market. Gardner was about to venture into another room when one of the CSIs caught his attention. "What's up?" "The pathologist would like a word, sir." The two officers left the living room and headed up to the bedroom. They found Fitz kneeling by the side of the body with a thermometer in his hand. "You called?" said Reilly. "Yes, I think you need to see this." Fitz had positioned Jane Carter onto her back, and her negligee was now up around her shoulders. The pathologist pointed to two bruises on her stomach. Both were large, inflamed. The outer edges of both were red, the centre deep blue. "There's a lot of swelling around the abdomen. It looks unnatural." and in my opinion, this lady will have suffered terribly before she died.
Any idea what caused them? Gardner asked.
Not until I have the chance to examine her thoroughly.
You don't think it's anything to do with the tablets? Asked Reilly.
Fitz stood up.
No, in my opinion, these are contact bruises.
What, like a truck?
Fitz continued.
There's no external bleeding, but I suspect she had some damage to the internal organs, which has caused them to swell. Pain would have been quite intolerable.
So she's been attacked with something? Said Reilly.
Very possibly.
Fitz pointed to the smaller of the bruises.
That one, I really have no idea.
And the other?
Gardner sighed.
It's a different shape, I could hazard a guess.
Go on, pushed Gardner.
A footprint?
Maybe.
Chapter 6. It was after 12 when Manny returned to consciousness. He immediately wished he hadn't. Rolling round to squint at the clock on the bedside cabinet, he winced. He had a headache to compete with the world's best. The little men with hammers were working up a sweat. His eyeballs really hurt, as if someone had taken a pan scrubber to them. The inside of his mouth felt like he'd chewed a carpet that had been in a skip for 6 months.
Oh, fuck me, is that what time it is?
Manny sat up far too quickly. His head fell forward, his eyes nearly vacated the premises, his stomach lurched, and his toes curled, as a shooting pain passed through his body like a wave of radiation.
Have a fucking heart, Lord. I know I've misbehaved, but the punishment does not fit the crime.
He laid back down, but that only made things worse. As he tried to leave the bed, his foot became caught in a sheet, and instead of disentangling, he simply dragged the whole thing with him to the bathroom, where he faced the sink and dry heaved for what felt like forever, leaving his stomach muscles tender as if they had been put through a mincer. Manny fell to the floor.
What the fuck did I do?
Despite the sun shining through the bathroom window, he still felt cold and shivery. He tried to piece things together. He remembered leaving the house with his ill-gotten gains. He hot-footed it through the town, using all the back alleys and ginnels he knew about, and one or two he didn't. A light suddenly beamed inside Manny's head. He'd passed the off-license, where some kind soul had left a bottle of 3-year-old oak-barrel aged French brandy out in the yard. It had either been forgotten, which he doubted, or the slack bastard that worked there had been intending to steal it. That was when Manny remembered the old saying, "The Lord helped those who helped themselves." So he did. The trouble started in the early hours when he reached his home and deposited everything into the living room. In the kitchen, he'd taken another can of Red Bull from the fridge and downed it in one. After eating a sausage roll long past its sell-by date, he then opened the brandy and poured a glass. Or two. Or three, fucked if he could remember. Feeling more like moving, he stood up, slowly. The sheet fell to the floor, revealing everything Manny had, which wasn't much. Prisoners of war from Belsen were in better shape than him. He was about to rinse his mouth, but thought better of it. He glanced around the small bathroom. Chipped tiles, flaky ceiling, no bath, only a shower with a curtain so old it would have made a better sieve. He continually had to dry the bathroom floor. Sometimes it was easier not to take a shower. Manny made a mental note to acquire another curtain. It was time to try walking. He lived in a one-bedroom flat in the old town in Bramfield, known as Carpenter's Yard. So called because at the bottom of the yard there had been a dry dock where carpenters worked on the keels. It had been very busy down there in the early part of the last century. All that had gone now, and in its place were two small flats, his and the woman's next door. Hers had two bedrooms. Each flat also had a garage. They were huge, even had lofts. Manny's was full of shit. Hers wasn't. That was a matter of opinion. Mary had a pale blue VW Beetle. Bastard thing, especially when she revved the knackers off it early in the morning, going to see her mother in the care home. It was a wonder she didn't hear it, and that place was 5 fucking miles away. The courtyard had been bricked, with 2 large gas lamps installed. A patio table and chairs had been dropped dead centre, and a set of gates closed off the secluded...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.